The recent revelations by one company, Mossack Fonseca, based in tiny Panama, has turned the whole political establishment of Britain and the world on its head. These revelations of the most extraordinary and far-reaching character affect practically every country in the world, as far as one can see. Of course, the British media makes a big fuss about Vladimir Putin, who undoubtedly is a gangster that has enriched himself at the expense of plundering the Russian people and the Russian oligarchy, of course. Yes, but they make a big noise about Putin. They don't say quite so much about Poroshenko, the Ukrainian, who apparently has got an even bigger amount of money stashed away, plundered from the unfortunate people of the Ukraine. But then, of course, Poroshenko is one of our guys, isn't he? They make a big fuss about the Chinese leaders. Yes, but it isn't just the Chinese and the Russian and the Ukrainian and the Brazilian and the Icelandic leaders that are affected. It's above all Britain that needs to be put under a microscope in relation to this vast, appalling scandal, which really, if you think about it, is just the tip of the iceberg. I mean, after all, you're talking here about one company, Mossack Fonseca. It's just one company. This vast amount of information has come from this source alone. And yet, you see, according to the information I've seen, over half the companies which are named for tax dodging, for swindling on an epic scale, over half of them are based in British-administered territories, such as the Cayman Islands, and the Virgin Islands, and other Caribbean playgrounds for the rich. Oh, and don't forget those playgrounds for the rich which are nearer to home, such as Jersey and Guernsey, an absolute abomination in this day and age that such tiny and undemocratic territory should be allowed to exist. And yet any suggestion, which is an elementary thing, that these pirate strongholds should be brought under government control, oh, God forbid. Howls of protest about trampling the rights of these poor, unfortunate territories, who of course are awash with money. From the figures that I've seen, the Cayman Island alone, as far as I can see, or rather all these territories, I think it is, I've got more combined wealth than all the wealth which is created in Great Britain in a year, which is an astonishing situation, if you come to think about it. And what this really underlines in people's minds is the unjust nature of society. It really is a scandal that in the crisis of 2008, all that happened, these gangsters destroyed the entire fabric, the entire structure, the entire edifice of the world financial system. It was destroyed by a handful of parasitic gangsters in the city of London, in Wall Street and other centres of financial power. This sparked off a world economic crisis involving the loss of thousands of jobs, the destruction of whole economies, the ruin of whole countries. How many bankers, of course, have been brought to justice, have been put in the dock, have been put in prison as a result of this monstrous sabotage of the entire world financial system? Not one that I can think of, certainly not in Britain. Nobody has been prosecuted or even sacked for incompetence. And all that they've succeeded in doing, if you think about it, since 2008, when the taxpayers, the governments of America, of Britain, of France, of all countries, of Germany, poured in trillions of pounds, of dollars, of euros, into the private banks in order to prop them up. By the way, what's left of the logic of private enterprise, where the state was not supposed to intervene? Well, the state had to intervene to prop up the so-called private market economy like a man on crutches. And all that they've succeeded in doing, you see, since that time, is to turn what was a gigantic black hole in the finances of private banks into a gigantic black hole of the public finances. You see, it's all very well saying, oh, the state will save, the government will save the banks. Yes, but there's just one little detail, you see. The government hasn't got any money, hasn't got a beam, other than at what it raises from taxes. So talk about benefit fraud and people sponging off the state. Here's benefit fraud on a vast scale. The banks, the private banks, were propped up by public money, by your money and my money, through the state. And now they turn around and say, look, there's no money. I'm very sorry. No money for hospitals, no money for schools. The other day, it was announced just in the last 24 hours, that there's a crisis in Britain in the National Health Service, manifested in a crisis, a grave crisis of the accident and emergency services, which are no longer fit for purpose. So people will be left to die as a result of this alleged lack of money. Schools, it was just announced recently, yesterday in fact, that it is estimated that now this year there will be not enough places, this autumn, there will be not sufficient primary school places for little children to go to. Because, why? Because there is no money, you understand. Yes, there's no money because the rich do not pay taxes. Now get a load of this. You always suspected that, didn't you? That the rich didn't pay taxes. Well, now you don't have to suspect it. You know that they do not pay taxes. Deliberately, fraudulently, brazenly, these guys with all the money do not pay taxes. They salt the money away to the Cayman Islands or whatever. It's now been revealed. And what hypocrisy, what blatant, what brazen, what astonishing hypocrisy on the part of people like David Cameron, you know, to trust me, I'm a Tory Prime Minister, this guy. The left-wing Tory progressive Honest John Prime Minister, who swore, by the way, not long ago, he swore, before he became Prime Minister, that he never had anything to do with the offshore companies and so on. Well, not so. It's now been revealed that the cat is out of the bag. Of course, first of all, he tried to deny it. This Honest John Prime Minister of ours, he'd make a good confidence trickster, wouldn't he? In the wrong job, perhaps, you know. Oh, yes. What's the first reaction of Number 10 Downing? Oh, it's a private matter. Now, my friend, you try this. You try telling the tax inspector next time he calls on your small business or calls on your house or you haven't filled in your income tax form. Oh, it's a private matter. Don't bother me. It's a private matter. Yes, that didn't wear. Incidentally, what a weak, what a tepid, it was as weak as dishwater, the reaction of the official Labour Party spokesman. I was quite scandalised when I saw that. They went along with this guff. Oh, yes, it's a private matter. We're not after David Cameron, really. Is that a fact? Yes, but the public indignation was such that the Labour Party had to step up its campaign a little bit. A little bit of pressure was applied on Mr. Cameron, with the result, every day that passed, new revel he was forced to make. I mean, talk about a Prime Minister that's in favour of transparency. That's the line now. Oh, we're all in favour of transparency. It's about as transparent as a sea of ink. It had to be dragged out of him. It had to be dragged out. Each day, new revelations, he had to admit, oh yes, well, he did have some shares, but only 30,000 worth in a company which his dad set up. Of course, posh boy is from a wealthy family, naturally. His dad set up this guy specifically with the aim of avoiding taxation. What do you think of that? That's a fact. But oh no, it's nothing to. Of course, now new revelations have come out. Nobody believes that the amount of money which Mr. Cameron declares is the truth. Oh, he says then, oh, I sold these shares in 2010. Well, maybe he did. But that he and his family still have a considerable amount of shares, large amounts in offshore companies which they've not declared, which they are concealing, I don't think anyone seriously doubts this. I note that the Daily Mirror received a lot of people. They did a kind of survey, not a scientific survey, but interesting nonetheless. 95% Of those who responded said that Cameron should resign, Cameron should go. And that's a fact. Look, in tiny Iceland, I mean, hardly one would think a hotbed of revolution. You think about Iceland, you know. It'd be the last country in God's earth you would think about. And yet here you've had a revolutionary movement on the streets of protest leading to the overthrow of the Prime Minister, who lied in his teeth again. Prime Minister of Iceland, who lied about his not having shares in offshore companies, which he did. They took to the streets and by God they got rid of this gangster. Now they're still on the streets demanding the resignation of the whole government. I don't know what's wrong with us in Britain. We're a bit too respectable, I fear, in cases such as these. Because it isn't just Cameron, you see. And Cameron is wriggling under the spotlight of public scrutiny. Yes, but the whole Tory party, the whole establishment is rotten. It's full of cheats and crooks and spivs and gangsters. Every single one of them. The City of London itself, which of course is the basis of the Tory, is the Tory party is based on the city. That's who it represents, not you and me. The City of London is the centre, the nerve centre, the main centre of this gigantic, stinking spider's web of corruption, of rottenness, of bribery, of tax evasion, of crookedness, which spans the whole terrestrial globe. The Tory party is full of crooks, no question of it. This gangster who's standing for Mayor of London, Zach Goldsmith, I think his name is, yes, this gangster. His loot, of course, is in Switzerland. It's not in the Cayman Islands. Don't worry, girls and boys. It's not in the Cayman Islands. It's in Switzerland, so that's okay. He has two houses, however. Two very expensive, two very smart houses. Which, of course, are registered where? In the Cayman Islands. So he's a crook. And then there's another guy. What's his name? John Maples, I think his name is. Former Tory MP, former vice chairman of the Tory party. John Maples, yes, Mr. Maples, set up a company called, I believe, Maples and Calder, I think it's called, which is the biggest, it is said to be the biggest, it's the biggest tax avoidance law firm in the world. That's not a bad record for a Tory former vice chairman, is it? And they're all the same, they're all in the swim. I don't know how many right-wing Labour MPs, by the way, are involved in this, we shall see. But the fact of the matter is, it isn't just one or two individuals. The whole establishment is corrupt, that's a plain fact. And the question arises on this question of tax. You see, I happen to know, I think all of you are aware of the fact, from your own personal experience, the tax man is not easily avoided in the United Kingdom, you know. I mean, as far as the poor are concerned, they're not. And they've got this whole edifice of propaganda, which is day in, day out, churning out the business about benefits, cheats, and how people are not paying their taxes, and so on. Yes, you try it. You try it. You'll soon find that an inspector of Her Majesty's Inland Revenue will be knocking on your door and sending you nasty letters. And you will have to pay. Yes, they pursue the poor people, the unemployed, poor chap that is just unemployed and short of money and takes a little bit of a job on the side, doesn't declare it to the tax. They're downing him like a ton of bricks. You better believe it. So the question arises, is this interesting question, my friends. Question is this. How come that these massive swindles involving millions and billions of pounds, not a couple of quid that a local guy gets by driving a taxi in his spare time. No. These are huge quantities of money which should go to the state, which should be used for building hospitals and schools and paying pensions for senior citizens. How could it go on? You mean to say the tax didn't know about this? You mean to say that the income of the guys who get paid a lot of money to look after the public finances and taxation were not aware of these swindles? Don't give me that. Don't make me laugh. Of course they knew about it. They knew all the time, and they know all the time. It's a matter of fact, I think he was exposed the other day. Oh, surprise, surprise. One of the main tax inspectors in Britain's been had out for fiddling. Oh, yes. They're all on the fiddle, my friends, in the upper echelons of Her Majesty's income tax, inland revenue. They're all on the fiddle. You better believe it. And by the way, they couldn't, these guys couldn't get away with these swindles unless they had the collaboration of the, if they were in cahoots with these high tax officials. Oh, and lo and behold, I don't know if you know this, you can check the records. All these guys, the big, I'm not talking about the local small tax inspectors who are honest, poorly paid workers like the rest of us. No, the big boys. The chief executives of the tax, when they retire, where do they go? Oh, surprise, surprise, they all end up as advisors to big companies, offshore companies, and companies based in the City of London. Plum jobs, earning them millions. And of course, one asks one says, how do they get these jobs? Well, very simple. By turning a blind eye, by doing a Nelson, by ignoring the vast crooked swindling that's taking place, which is depriving the Chancellor of the Exchequer of billions of pounds every year. It is a gigantic, monstrous, scandalous swindle. And you're only seeing just the tip of the iceberg in relation to this. What's done about it? Well, nothing's done about it. You mentioned Her Majesty's inland revenue. Oh, they're honest guys. They do a hard job. But no doubt the ordinary income tax inspector does an honest job. I'm not referring to that. I'm referring to the rottenness and the corruption which extends to the top echelons of the British state, including Her Majesty's inland revenue. Now, what's the crux of this? What does it boil down to? Well, first of all, it is manifestly clear to anyone except a complete idiot that what you have in Britain and all other countries is government, not a democracy. No, what are you talking about, democracy? It is government of the rich, by the rich, and for the rich, and for nobody else. So there's no money. That's the song, isn't it? You know, oh, we've got a deficit. You've got a deficit partly because the taxes are not paid. Not the small guys, but the big guys, which are robbing the people of Britain of billions. Legally robbing. Oh, yes, the law. It's within the law, we are told. Yes, the law. Somebody said the law is an ass. I think that's from Shakespeare. It's his anniversary this weekend, so that's appropriate. The law is an ass. Yeah, not such an ass, my friend. The law is quite smart, really. You know what Solon the Great said about the law? Solon the Great of Athens. He wrote the Constitution of Athens a long time ago. He said, the law is like a spider's web. The small are caught and the great tear it up. Yes, how appropriate. How appropriate to the present laws concerning taxation in Britain and internationally. This is an international phenomenon. One thing that strikes me. Here you got all these countries are named, China, Russia, the Ukraine, Iceland, Peru, Brazil, any country under the sun except for one, which mysteriously is quite absent in all these startling revelations, and that is the United States of America, God bless her, and all who sail in her. Now I wonder why that is, when Panama is run by the United States in effect. I wonder why it is that none of the big US corporations and politicians are involved in this scandal. Now, my friends, if you can believe that, you can believe anything. I don't think the people of Britain are children. The people of the United States are children. Little children that they believe in fairy stories. Oh, no. This is rigged. And the biggest riggers of the lot, of course, are based in Wall Street and in Washington. And you bet your bottom dollar that, as I say, this is just the tip of the iceberg of a system, not talking about individual crooks here, but individual people. It's not a question of individuals. It is an entire economic and financial and political and social system which is rotten to the core. And there's only one thing that can be done with an edifice which is rotten to the core, to the very foundations. That's to overthrow it by the means that the people of Iceland, to their credit, have shown are possible and will be possible. I'm certain of this, in one country after another, that is to say, a fundamental change in society. That is known, in case you didn't know it, as a revolution.